Hello. So this is the sixth session. The title of this session is going to be something as the general Cauchy theorem. And if time allows, residue theorem. I'm not sure if I will have time to write to residue theorem. If not, it would be the continuation of the session tomorrow. Okay. So we have stated and more or less proved, not with full details, but the Cauchy theorem for a disk. That, as I remember, said that you have something like this. You have, okay, where in this case the path gamma, the path was the circle. You were on the circle, okay. This equality is true if Z is in the disk, surrounded by the circle. Okay. In fact, we could slightly improve this equality. It's writing the following: Fz. If we write Fz times the index we have defined in the last session of the circle on Z equals 2 pi I 1 over 2 pi I. The integral around along C of the function, and this equality would be valid for every Z in this case, for every Z in C except on the circle, because well, on the circle you know the equality, this number is 1, and outside the circle the index is 0, so at the on the left hand side you have 0, but on the right hand side you you also have 0, because if Z is a point outside the circle, the function f of omega, f is a holomorphic function, divided by omega minus Z in a neighborhood of the circle, Z is far from here, in this neighborhood has a primitive. You can find a convex set here. This function is well defined. There has a primitive, so this integral is 0. So you have 0 to both sides. So this this equality could be improved in this way. So this is going to be the more or less the general statement of a general Cauchy theorem. General Cauchy theorem is essentially the theorem we have just stated, but with more general conditions. I'm not going to prove the general Cauchy theorem. The proof is quite long, quite involved, but only to give the statement and give an idea. So the general Cauchy theorem says essentially the following. Consider, I'm going to announce general Cauchy theorem. Okay, consider an open set U, any open set in this case, and a loop, gamma loop on U, containing U. Verify the following condition. Verify such that for every point that is not in U, the index of this loop around this point is 0. I'm going to put A here, for instance, is 0. We'll make an example after that. Consider this condition. So a loop verifying this condition. Then consider a function holomorphic on U. Then for every Z in U, you have the following. For every set in U, you have that u minus gamma, you have that f z times the index of the loop gamma around the point z is equal to 1 over 2 pi I times the integral along gamma of this function. Okay, so the condition is essentially the same. The statement is essentially the same as in the particular case, simply replacing the circle by any loop. And we have some condition here. What does it mean, this condition? What does it mean, this condition? Imagine, for instance, you have your open set something like this. Your open set. I always draw the open set like this, but it's not a general open set. Imagine your open set has a hole, or even several holes. Your open set may have holes. So your open set is this one. So it is not allowed, for instance, to have this path. A path like this would not be allowed. Why? In this theorem, why is not allowed? Because there are points outside you. If you take a point here outside you, the index of this path around this point is 1. This path makes one turn around this point, and you need that this index must be 0. For instance, this is verified this is always verified if your open set has not holes. I mean, if the open set, the complement of the open set has only the one connected component, let's say. As connected component is only the rest of the non-bounded. You have a bounded open set, for instance, and the connected component of the complement is also bounded, is also connected, has only one connected component, but not in this case. Let's see. But it could be verified, for instance, imagine you have something like this, U, and you have holes. And imagine you have some path that goes like this. There's a turn here, there's a turn here. Imagine this is your path. Well, for this path, Cauchy theorem would be valid. Why? Okay, consider the points outside you. If you take a point here, what does it? This path essentially makes a turn, counterclockwise. After that, it goes far away. Doesn't matter. Now it makes another turn clockwise, and it goes far away, and it returns to the original point. So around this point, it has made two turns, one turn counterclockwise, another turn clockwise. So the index is 0 around this point. And the same around some point here. It is the same. The index is also 0. And of course, the index with respect to a point outside you is also 0. So this path would be a path satisfying the hypothesis of the general Cauchy theorem. So what it says is that if you take some path like this, for every point which is not on the path, this equality is verified, essentially. Okay, this is a general version. There is a slight, even a more general version that I will state in a few moments, but this is more or less the general version. There is a second part of this general version that says the following thing. This is the first event. We have that, and the second part of this general Cauchy theorem would be that, moreover, the integral of f is 0. Integral of f is 0. This second part can be deduced more or less easily from that part there, because you can consider the function g of omega something like this. You can consider this function and apply the first part to this function. So essentially, at the end, you obtain that this is zero, and you make some in your point, yes, replacing the variable by z, you have here z minus z. So at the left hand side you have zero, and here you have this integral where the omega minus z has cancelled in the both sides. So using this function, you deduce this part. So the integral along any path, that the integral of a homomorphic function along any path, such that the index of this path with respect to any point of the on the exterior of the set U is zero, this integral must be zero. Okay, and this is what says the general Cauchy theorem. There is a more general version that uses, instead of using paths, using what is called cycles. What is a cycle? It's not complicated. Cycle is the following. Consider the unopened set U, and consider the set of all loops on U. Let's say set of all loops on U. So a cycle is going to be only a linear combination, a formal linear combination of cycles with integral coefficients. So a cycle is going to be something like this. And gamma and I times gamma I equal 1 to n, something like this, for instance, to m, I'm going to put here, where the n I are some integers and gamma I are loops. This is a formal linear combination. You take the free z module, the free z module with having a basis, the set of all loops on U, for instance. So it's a linear combination. And, well, you can speak about what does it mean, an integral L around a cycle. If this is a cycle, the integral of a function around a cycle, along a cycle, you can define in a straightforward way as this. Okay? And you can define the index of a cycle around some point. Again, it would be the sum of ni times this index. So the same statement would remain valid replacing loops by cycles. Loops by cycle. What is the interest of that? Because sometimes you may want to consider things like this. Instead of considering, let's say, one path, you may need to consider two paths. For instance, two separated paths, something like this, and to add. So sometimes it's convenient to consider this as a sum of two paths. So this is a cycle that is considered gamma 1, gamma 2, and you can speak formally as this sum. So sometimes it's useful to consider that. Okay? But, well, it's only a technical question, but the same result would be valid replacing here loops by cycles, and with the same hypothesis. For every point which is not on U, the index of the cycle around this point must be zero. If this condition is verified, this formula also applies and is a statement of the general Cauchy theorem. Okay? I'm not going to prove this theorem because, as I told, it's quite complicated. You can find in some old books there are long proofs, very long proofs. In fact, There are some proofs that are not so long. There is a proof due to Dixon that you can find in several books. For instance, in the book of Ash and Nobinger, you find this proof of Nobinger. You find the proof of Dixon. It's not really, really long, but well, it's sometimes involved. Or in the book of Rudin. Rudin, Walter Rudin, the book of real and complex analysis. You can find the general version, the most general version of the of this Cauchy theorem. Okay? But I'm not going to do the proof now, because it's quite complicated. So this result is going to be useful to find out which kind of open sets verify, essentially verify this condition. Verify that for any path, for any loop, the index with respect to any point in the complementary is zero. And this is going to be useful to find out, for instance, for what kind of open sets we know that any holomorphic function has a primitive or has a logarithm if it's non-zero. We know, for instance, that for a convex set, that's true. We know that for a star-shaped domain, it's true that any holomorphic function has a logarithm. But perhaps there are some more complicated open sets where you can say that any holomorphic function has a logarithm. So using this general Cauchy theorem, we are going to try to figure out how are these open sets. So we are going to comment the following result. Consider, well, first of all, the result is going to be called the second Cauchy theorem. And before stating this result, only one comment. We are working in C also. We are working on C. As I will make more precise in the next days, you have your plane C, and C must maybe complete it adding one point at infinity. Essentially, the plane, topologically, you may complete a plane adding one point at infinity, and you have a sphere, for instance. I will make it more precise in a couple of lectures when I will speak of the stereographic projection. But, well, this is something that you make in topology, for instance, to make the compactification of a space. Adding, if a space is locally compact, you can compactify any topological space adding one point, only one point. So you have more, in this case, you can interpret C as if it was, let's say, for instance, the sphere minus one point. You can interpret this like C. Here you have the origin, here you have, for instance, the circle of radius one, have all the different circles around the origin, and you add one point at infinity that glue all these points in the same way that sometimes it's useful to consider in the real context the real line completed with two points at plus infinity and minus infinity, and you have some compact set in this case that is topologically like an interval, a closed interval. Okay, so this I will make more precise in some days, but this set I will denote by C bar. I will denote by C bar. So the second Cauchy theorem says that the following: consider an open set U on C. An open set U. So the following are equivalent. The following conditions are equivalent. One, the complement on C bar of this set is connected. Two, for every point not in U, for every point not in U, and for every gamma contained, every loop gamma contained in U, the index of gamma around this point is zero. Three, for every holomorphic function on U, And every closed loop, closed path, for every loop gamma containing U, the integral of F is zero. For every holomorphic function, for every holomorphic function defined on U, F has a primitive. Five. If for every holomorphic function on U never zero, which is never zero, F has a logarithm. F has an analytic logarithm. And well, we make six. It's not so interesting now, six, but also in the same condition as before, for every holomorphic function which is never zero, F has roots of any order. And for every, let's say, k, n, there exists g, a holomorphic function, and u, such that g to the k is equal to f. So f has holomorphic roots of any order. And later we will simplify, we will in the next lectures, even sometimes I will add some equivalent conditions to this one. For instance, at some moment we will see that every any of these conditions is equivalent to say that the open set U is homeomorphic to the disk, to the open disk, to the unit disk, or that any function has a square root, not necessarily roots of any order, only a square root. The function has a square root, it's enough. But we cannot see that for a moment. We will see that in some lectures. Well, some of these conditions we have already seen that they are equivalent. But anyway, I'm going to comment some of them. For instance, the first condition, what says? Says that the complement, notice that I wrote the complement on C bar. So the complement on the set were adding the point at infinity. I mean, this, for instance, if my set, if my open set U would be, for instance, C minus zero, the complement on U of U on C is connected, because it's zero, one point. But the complement of U on C bar is not connected, because it's zero and infinity, two points. So this is not a valid set. It's not a valid set. I mean the complement on C bar. So the point at infinity is always in this complement. It's always in this complement. So I mean the complement must contain this point at infinity and is the only connected component of the complement. Okay? So one implies two by the fact that we have said that the index is zero in the let's say in the connected component, in the non-bounded connected component. The index is zero. And in this case is the only connected component. On the assuming one is true, is the only connected component of the complement of U. So the index is zero. The index is zero. So for in order to see two, for instance, we could apply the Cauchy theorem, the general Cauchy theorem, taking as a function here something like, for instance. Like a function, what is the good function to take here? Wait a moment. I think the function, the one moment, it's always something technical and I never remember. the point. Let me remember one moment. No, yes, well, this is already proven. Essentially, it's already proven. No, the other side, what is more complicated. As the complement is connected, this index is always zero. And in a point of the complement. For every z, we're not in u. What is slightly more complicated is this implication. I was remembering that there was some step that it was more complicated. I'm not going to prove that. What is the main idea? Assume that the geometrical idea is quite easy. Assume that you have an open set U such that for every path contained on U, the index with respect to any point not on U is zero. Why the complement is connected on U? Why the complement on U is connected? Why you are not allowed to have something like this true here? The idea is that you can always, and this is the complicated part, you can always show that there exists a, let's say, a path going around here. There exists, if you have, let's say, if the complement is not connected, you take some connected component of the complement, which is not the non-bounded component, and you can always construct some loop going once around that connected component, so such that the index for these points around these points is one, and the index for any other point here is zero. And this is quite technical to construct this path. Geometrically, it's quite clear. If there are several components in the complement, okay, you can always find some path here or some path here. That such that the index around any point here is one, and the index around any point or here is zero. And this would be a contradiction with the fact that the index with respect to any point that is not in U would be zero. So this is technical, but geometrically is not so complicated. Okay. For instance, why 2 implies 3? Okay, 2 implies 3 by general Cauchy theorem, for instance. General Cauchy theorem, the second part, says that for any holomorphic function, if this condition applies, the condition of 2 applies, the integral is 0. Okay, so this is general Cauchy theorem. 3 implies 4. In fact, 3 equivalent to 4, some sense, we have already shown. If the integral along any path is 0, we can find a primitive. And if there is a primitive, the integral along any closed path must be 0 of any holomorphic function. So 3 is equivalent to 4 in this sense. Okay, and okay. Why there is an analytic logarithm? For any, well, we saw before, you have some function different from zero, and you can take this function f prime over f. Using 4, this function has a primitive. G, and using G, you can construct an analytic logarithm. Okay, so 4 implies 5 without problem. And okay, and 5 implies 4, it must not be so difficult, I think, or perhaps it's not so useful, let me see. Or perhaps 5 implies 2. Sometimes it's easy to see. If every function has an analytic logarithm in the definition of the index, you have some function you can find and a logarithm of the function involved in the integral, and from that you can show that the, this index must be zero. I'm not doing all the details of the proof, but only commenting some of the details. Some of the steps can be proven, and the last thing I would like to comment is, for instance, 5 implies 6. Can be seen in the following way. If every function has an analytic logarithm, every function has, every non-zero function has a primitive, a root, simply in the following way. You have a function different from zero. This function is the exponential on another function, and take, for instance, g over k. G over k, so, well, s to the k is f. So if every function has a logarithm, every function has root of any order. And it's a little bit more complicated to show that there are roots of any order, there are roots of any order, you have logarithm. Roots of any order. Implying logarithm. This is a little bit more complicated, but it can be shown. This is in the book of Ash, this is proposed as an exercise. Ash is proposed as an exercise. So the main idea would be to show that, to see that there is a function f has a logarithm. Well, the main idea would be to show that f prime over f has a primitive, and well, you know that you have roots of any order, so you have e to jk, sorry, jk to k, there are functions jk to k equal to f, so f prime over f is something as k times jk prime over jk, essentially. And here, 1 over k, f prime over f, and using that, you can, in order to see that this function has a primitive, you want to show that the integral along any closed path of this function is zero. Essentially, and using this equality here, you know that this integral must be. Okay, how is the proof? I don't remember. There are some details. The idea is this integral essentially. Okay. This integral, the integral along some path of this function, jk prime over jk, can be interpreted, yes, as the integral of 1 over z over this along this path. A little bit more complicated, slightly more complicated, but so this would be the index of this path around zero, more or less. And essentially, you need to compute this integral and take a limit when k tends to infinity. So this side is going to tend to zero, and the other side is going to tend to zero. If this side tends to zero, the other side tends to zero. And as the other side can be interpreted as an index, this is an integer. It must be an integer. Well, there is 1 over 2 pi I missing here, okay? This is an integer. As it can interpret it, it can be interpreted as index around along some curve. So this must be an integer. This integral, if k is big enough, this is, I don't know what number, but anyway, if k is big enough, this must be in modulus smaller than 1. So at the right-hand side, if you have an integer that which in modulus is smaller than 1, it must necessarily be 0. So this number is 0 for k big enough. If this number is 0 for k big enough, this is 0 also for k big enough. So in particular, this is 0. So it's not an easy exercise. In the book of Ash, gives some hints, but it's more or less the idea to show that the existence of roots of any order implies the existence of a logarithm. In fact, in the book of Ash, the exercise is proposed in the following way. If it exists roots not of any order, but of a sequence of orders, you don't need necessarily all the orders. You only need that there exist roots of orders as high as you want, in order to be sure that this number can be made smaller than one. This is enough, okay? As I told you, as a consequence of some results that we will see in some days, it will be seen that, in fact, it's enough that the square root exists. So, well, I haven't given all the details of this theorem, of this second Cauchy theorem, but anyway, it makes a characterization of sets from such that any holomorphic function has a logarithm, or any holomorphic function non-zero has any holomorphic function has a primitive, or any holomorphic function non-zero has a logarithm. And essentially, they are any set, any open set, such that the complement on C bar is connected. These sets like this are sometimes called analytically, sets verifying these conditions are sometimes called analytically simply connected. So, one open set verifying any of these conditions, the open set on C, such that the complement on C bar is connected, or any of the other equivalent condition, sometimes will be called analytically simply connected. So these are exactly the open sets on C, such that primitives always exist. Logarithm of non-zero functions always exist. For instance, any convex set is in this category. In this category, any star-shaped domain is in this category, for instance. But of course, there are more. Let's consider, imagine some set like this. I'm going to. This is an open set, also, which is not. Is not convex, is not a star shape, but it falls into this category. The complement on C, for instance, is connected. The complement is all this part here. There is only one connected component. So every function defined on such open set would have a primitive always. Every function defined, every non-zero function defined on such open set would have always a logarithm. Okay, and this is a consequence of Cauchy theorem. As an exercise, you can complete some details because I have not given all the proofs of all the equivalences. Okay, this is what I wanted to say. Sometimes I will need perhaps the more general, this more general version of Cauchy theorem, and it's for that I have stated here. So one. The following subject I want to explore is, I would like to state as a consequence of this general Cauchy theorem, what is called residue theorem. So I will begin in today's lecture with defining what is a, trying to define more or less what is a residue. But perhaps I will not give the complete statement of the residue theorem, but anyway, I will begin today with that. So I need some definitions. Suppose you have an open set U, see, and a point on U. Consider a point on U. And now consider a function which is holomorphic on U, except on this point. sorry, function, which is not perhaps defined on z0, but is defined around this point. So this point z0 is going to be called an isolated singularity. An isolated singularity. Okay? How does a holomorphic function behaves around an isolated singularity? Several things may happen. First thing that may happen, well, perhaps f is bounded in a neighborhood of z0. Bounded in a neighborhood of z0. It's a possibility, perhaps it's not, but perhaps you have your point z0 here. The function is defined in a neighborhood. So perhaps there is a neighborhood of z0 where the function f is bounded, bounded in modulus. What's happening in this case? If it happens that f is bounded, consider now the function g of z equal z minus z0 times f. Consider this function, this product. Well, as f is bounded, and this function tends to 0 when z tends to z0, this function tends to 0. So limit of g of z when z tends to z0 is 0. Okay? A product of a bounded function by something that which tends to 0. Okay? So g can be extended to z0 continuously because the limit exists. So assume you can consider this function defined like this and 0 if z equals z0. So this is a holomorphic function on u minus z0 and continuous on z0. And yesterday in one of the preceding lectures we saw that there is a version of Goursat's theorem that says that if we have a function that is holomorphic everywhere except at one point where it is continuous, the integral along any triangle was 0 also. In particular, this function had a primitive. This was necessary to have a primitive. And if a function has a primitive, this function is the derivative of a holomorphic function, so it is itself holomorphic. I mean, if a function is holomorphic at every point except at one point, and it is continuous at that point, in fact, it is holomorphic at that point. Okay? So, this function g is, in fact, holomorphic on u. So you can find the power series expansion of g around the point z0. So you can write, and as the value of g in z0 is 0, a 0 must be 0. So I'm going to write like this. If g is z minus z0 times f of z, and g around z0 is this function, around this point z0, f must be this function. Dividing by z minus z0. So f can be expanded in power series around z0. So in fact, f is holomorphic. So if you have an isolated singularity and a function is bounded around in the neighborhood of this isolated singularity, this function in fact can be extended holomorphically to this point, z0. This is sometimes called Riemann a removable singularities theorem. Singularity theorem. So any such singularity can be removed. In fact, the function can be extended to that point. Okay, so this isolated singularity, in fact, is not exactly a singularity, it's going to be called a removable singularity. Removable singularity. Okay, this is one, the first possibility. The function is bounded. Second possibility we may have. Assume that the function tends to infinity. Second possibility, assume that limit of fz when z tends to f0 is infinity. Well, this is the same to say that the modulus tends to infinity. It's not only non-bounded, but it tends to infinity. Okay? Well, if it tends to infinity, we may consider this function. This function is defined around in a neighborhood. In a neighborhood of the point z0, not in z0, but if it tends to infinity near the point z0, the function is not zero. So it makes sense to consider this function. And this function, call it g, verifies that the limit of g when z tends to z0 is zero. If it tends to infinity, this quotient is going to tend to zero. So z0 is a removable singularity for this function g. So g can be extended. G can be extended to z0 and having in z0 having some zero of some order. So if we develop the function g around this point, can be written something like this. There is a zero of some order times an, I'm going to write like this, where a zero is not zero. So perhaps the first term, like as here, was zero. Perhaps there are some terms that are zero, and I remove all these terms. I put here all the terms, and I put the rest. So this function can be written, this is h. So the function g can be written as z minus z0 to some power m, m greater or equal than 1. Times a holomorphic function in a neighborhood of z0, a holomorphic function h, that such that h of z0 is not zero. So one, so f, which is 1 over g, is something as 1 over something like this. This is a holomorphic function around z0. And, well, it is not. But anyway, this, as this is a holomorphic function, it can be written as a formal power series expansion like this. It has some expansion, okay? So there is some expansion of this function around this point like this. Bn. So around any such point, function can be developed as a kind of power series, but having some terms with negative exponent, but a finite number of them. A finite number of terms with negative exponent. Okay, the terms here begin, when n equals to zero, begin in minus m. This point is going to be called, if this condition happens, it's going to be a pole of f. A pole of f, and the number m is going to be called the order of the pole. So a pole would be a point, an isolated singularity, such that the function tends to infinity in this point, and the function can be developed as a power series, but with some terms having a finite number of terms having negative exponents here. Okay? This would be the second possibility. And there is the remaining possibility that I will study more deeply in the next session. The remaining possibility. So the first one is the function is bounded around the singularity. The second one is the function tends to infinity. And the remaining case, the remaining case, 3, is going to be called an essential singularity. The function is neither bounded nor tends to infinity. It may happen. For instance, consider the function exponential of 1 over z. This is a holomorphic function on c minus 0. 0 is an isolated singularity. And this function, when z tends to 0, is not bounded. For instance, if z tends to 0 along the positive numbers, the real positive numbers, 1 over z tends to plus infinity as a real number, and this tends to infinity, so it's not bounded. But the function does not tend to infinity here. If you, for instance, z tends to 0 along the negative real numbers, 1 over z tends to minus infinity. And the exponential or something that tends to minus infinity tends to 0. So along this line, the function tends to 0. So in any neighborhood of 0, the function is nor bounded, neither bounded nor tends to infinity. So this is the remaining case. And in this case, the function is going to be called an essential singularity. And I will state tomorrow that also around an essential singularity, a function can be developed in some sense as a certain power series having negative exponents, but an infinity number of them. Perhaps not a finite number of negative exponents, but an infinity number of negative exponents around any essential singularity. And this would be the difference among the three. After that, this is stated, this will be in the next session, I will state the residue theorem that would be very useful to make lots of computations and to draw a lot of conclusions about some holomorphic functions. I finish here. Thank you.